أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين وبعد. So our topic for today that we're going to speak about inshallah is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Now Ibrahim alayhi salam, many of us, you know, we know about Ibrahim alayhi salam, we know about his story. Raise your hand if you've learned, I'm not talking about the whole life of Ibrahim, but you know a story of Ibrahim because there are many. Raise your hand if you know a story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Okay, so most of us know quite a bit about Ibrahim alayhi salam. But today we're going to be talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam in a way that perhaps many of you have not heard about him. And you'll find that the majority of my talk, inshallah, I'm not going to be speaking about Ibrahim himself. But towards the end, everything will come together, inshallah. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sends prophets and messengers. Allah, He says, Allahu yastafi minal malaikati rusulan wa minan nas. Allah, He says that He sends, or Allah chooses from amongst the malaika, messengers, as well as from amongst the people, from the human beings. So we know from this ayah, and it's at the end of Surah Al-Hajj, Allah, He says that He chooses messengers from the angels, as well as the human beings. So there are messengers not only from the human beings, but from the angels as well. Amongst those messengers is Jibreel alayhi salam. Jibreel was the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the messenger of Allah to the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his teacher was Jibreel. His teacher was Jibreel. So Jibreel was sent with the Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the last of the messengers. So there are no more messengers from the human beings living today. Others may claim so, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that he's the last of the prophets. Now, when it comes to the prophets and the messengers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهُ فَبِهُدَاهُمْ قُتَدِهُ. Allah tells us in Surah Al-An'am, after mentioning many of the prophets and the messengers, Allah mentioned the story of Ibrahim, Allah mentioned the story of Nuh, Allah mentions Nuh by name, and Allah mentions many of the other prophets by name. And then at the end of speaking about the prophets, Allah, He says, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهُ. They are the ones that Allah has guided. So Allah tells us that He has guided the prophets and the messengers, فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِهُ. So with their guidance, follow. So there's a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us about these stories in the Quran. He tells us about the prophets. You're not going to find, you know, a surah except that it has perhaps a story. It has, you know, an example of somebody that lived before us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, فَقُصُصِ الْقَصَصَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Allah says, tell them the stories, addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tell them stories so that they may think and contemplate. Because if I give you a long lecture about this and that, and I don't mention any stories, perhaps you may not remember it, right? A week from now, you're not going to remember, but stories, we all remember stories. And stories are enjoyable, right? Stories are fun to listen to. And nobody likes a boring story, right? But the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, wallahi, it's amazing. It's amazing. Now Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to think about him and to reflect upon his life. Allah, He says, وَذْكُرُ فِي الْكِتَابِ Ibrahim. Allah mentions, and remember Ibrahim in the scripture. إِنَّهُ كَانَ صِدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا. He was a truthful man. He was truthful. He was loyal. Ibrahim alayhi salam did not betray Allah. Right? He did not go against Allah and he did not follow his own whims and desires. And he was a prophet. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commands us to remember Ibrahim alayhi salam. Now, Ibrahim alayhi salam, He is our imam. He's our imam. Now, of course, Ibrahim alayhi salam, He's not alive in our times. He died a long time ago, as well as all of the other prophets except Isa alayhi salam. All of the prophets are dead except Isa alayhi salam. Now, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah, He says, وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَّمَّهُنْ. Allah, He says in Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah tested Ibrahim with certain commandments, Allah commanded Ibrahim to do certain things and he completed all of them. He completed all of them. Allah then says to Ibrahim, قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. Allah says to Ibrahim that I will make you an imam for the people. So Allah tells us that Ibrahim, very clearly, he is an imam for the people. Now, what is he an imam in? Ibrahim, he is an imam for us in his belief and his methodology, his way of living. Allah, he says, ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ أَنِ اتَّبِعْ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Allah, he says, then we have revealed to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow the way of Ibrahim, worshipping Allah alone. He used to worship Allah alone. وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And he was not from amongst those who associated partners with Allah. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he is our imam and he is our role model. Now, when it comes to Ibrahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has chosen Ibrahim, he has given him one of the greatest statuses amongst the messengers. Now we know that the mightiest of the messengers are five. Who are they? Who are the mightiest of the messengers, the greatest of the messengers, the most strong-willed of all of the messengers that Allah has sent? There are five. Ibrahim is one of them, so you got four left. Who else? Musa. So we got Ibrahim, we have Musa. Who else? Nuh. Who else? Isa alayhi salam and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. Right? Allah, he says, فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. Allah, he commands the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, be patient, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just as the strong-willed messengers were patient before you. Meaning, Ibrahim, Nuh, Isa, and Musa alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given Ibrahim amongst the greatest of statuses, amongst even the messengers. Now Ibrahim alayhi salam, some of the things that made him great, like we've mentioned, Allah has made him an imam because he fulfilled all of those commandments. Now what was he commanded to do? Now, when Ibrahim alayhi salam was young, what is a trial that he had to go through? What is something that Ibrahim had to deal with as a young man, as a young child? What did he have to deal with? Idol worship. How? Good, his father, Ibrahim's father. What was his father's name? Azar, right? Allah, he says, وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ أَزَرَ أَتَّتَّخِذُ أَصْنَامًا آلِهًا. Allah says, and remember Ibrahim, when he said to his dad, he said to his father Azar, are you going to take these idols as gods? So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he told his people, in another verse, he told them, أَفْرَأَيْتُمْ مَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْبُدُونَ. He's speaking to his whole society, because everybody used to worship idols in his society. There was nobody that was worshiping Allah alone except him. So Ibrahim, he said to his people, do you not think about what you're worshiping? You're worshiping stones, you're worshiping statues. If a fly were to land on one of these statues, this is not the speech of Ibrahim, this is just my explanation. Meaning he's telling them that it doesn't make any sense. If a fly were to land or to use the bathroom on one of these idols, it wouldn't be able to protect itself. So Ibrahim told him, does this really make sense? Does it help you? Does it listen to you? Does it speak to you? You give it food, you put food in front of it, it doesn't even eat. The food goes to waste. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he opposed his entire society, right? He wasn't a wimp. He didn't compromise his deen, a little bit of peer pressure. Imagine, his entire society went against him. And it came to a point where they wanted to burn him. Allah mentions, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions that they said, حَرِّقُوهُ وَانْصُرُوا أَلِهَتَكُمْ. His people said to Ibrahim, that we're going to burn you. They said to each other, burn him and help your idols. Help your idols against Ibrahim. So they eventually threw him into a fire to murder him. And his father consented to this, his entire family, they were ready to murder him. They threw him into the fire, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him from that fire. So Ibrahim, he came out. After that, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was commanded to slaughter his son. Later on, he got married, and he had a son, Ismail, and Allah commanded him to kill his own son. Allah commanded him in a dream to slaughter his son. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ وَنَادَيْنَاهُ أَيَّا إِبْرَاهِيمُ قَدَ صَدَّقَتَ الرُّؤْيَا. Allah mentions that Ibrahim, he was commanded by Allah in a dream to slaughter his son, to take a knife and to cut the throat of his son, to slaughter his own son, Ismail. And Allah mentions in the Quran, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعِي. Allah mentions that this was at an age where Ismail, he was able to run with his father, to walk with his father outside. And some of the scholars of tafsir mentioned that this is when Ismail was 7 years old. When he was 7 years old, imagine you have a young child. And when a young child dies, it's not like your older child dying. It's not the same. It's not the same thing. And parents who have lost children, they can attest to this. It's not the same thing. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was commanded to slaughter his own son. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that Ibrahim, he laid down his son on the ground. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that he turned his son on the side where his forehead is on the ground. And Ibrahim has the knife in his hand. And he's about to cut the neck of his son, to slaughter his son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls out to Ibrahim saying, "Oh Ibrahim, قَدْ صَدَّقَتَ الرُّؤْيَا." You have fulfilled the dream. You have fulfilled the test. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he then says, وَفَدَيْنَاهُ بِذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down a ram so that Ibrahim can slaughter the ram instead of Ismail. In other words, this is what he was really supposed to slaughter, not his son. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just wanted to test his submission. Allah azza wa jal commands him to build the Kaaba. Allah azza wa jal commands him to build the Kaaba, and he constructs the Kaaba according to its original foundation. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was also, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells us in a very interesting hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. It's an authentic hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, اختتنَ إبراهيم عليه السلام وهو ابن ثمانين سنة وهو ابن ثمانين سنة بالقدوم. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Ibrahim circumcised himself. He circumcised himself, and that's not enough. He circumcised himself when he was 80 years old. He was 80 years old. Imagine an old man. He's, you know, it's not like a baby, right? Where, you know, babies, they get circumcised. He circumcised himself when he was 80 years old. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, bil qaddum, with an axe. With an axe. Can you imagine this? How painful that must have been? You know, this was thousands of years ago. They didn't have the anesthetics that we have today. You know, you know, just pop a painkiller in your mouth. It didn't work like that. You had to deal with the pain, deal with the agony. And this was something that Allah tested him with, and he did it. And he did it. Can you imagine this? Just, I mean, you know, just reflect on that for a second. Imagine if Allah commanded us to do that. Alhamdulillah, Allah has made the religion easy, right? Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمْ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمْ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants ease for you, and Allah doesn't want difficulty for you. Remember, He's on a completely different level. This is Ibrahim alayhi salam. He's on a different level. Allah has not commanded us to do things like this, but you know, to actually do it with ourselves with something like an axe. But this was the commandment that Ibrahim alayhi salam, that he fulfilled. And it's because of all of these commandments that he fulfilled, because of his patience, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. And Allah took Ibrahim as a very close friend. Now Khalil, Allah has taken Ibrahim as a Khalil. Now, Khalil in the Arabic language is not just a friend. Khalil is like your closest friend that you have, the closest friend that you can possibly have. And Ibrahim is the only prophet besides Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we know of that got this title of Khalil. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in another narration reported by Imam Muslim, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ اتَّخَذَنِي خَلِيلًا كَمَا اتَّخَذَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. Ibrahim, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he announced to the people, he said to them that Allah has taken me as a Khalil, just as He has taken Ibrahim as a Khalil. So we only know of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ibrahim alayhi salam as being given the status of Khalil, you know, like an extremely close friend. Now can you imagine this, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking such a close friend from amongst the human beings. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had this status. Now Ibrahim, not only would he make dua for himself, not only would he worship Allah a lot, but he used to make dua a lot for his kids. He used to make dua a lot for his children, and this is a benefit that we get from this, is that we should make dua for our children, right? We should constantly make dua for our children, that they're going to be righteous. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he says, وَجَنُوبَنِي وَبَنِيَ أَنَّ عَبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. Ibrahim, he makes dua to Allah, he says, "Oh Allah, keep me and my children who will come after me, keep them away from idol worship." So Ibrahim, he was fearful from idol worship. You know, you have some brothers and sisters, they think, mashallah, I've made it. Mashallah, my beard is a certain length, I'm wearing a thobe, I have a miswak in my pocket, I got my prayer rug, my pants is above my ankles, all of these things are good. But some people think that, mashallah, I've done these things, I'm going to Jannah, that's it. Right? They say, mashallah, I'm righteous, I'm better than this person, I'm that person. This person is an innovator, this person is lost, this person is misguided, I am rightly guided. Some people think like this. But Ibrahim asked Allah, he said, "Oh Allah, keep me away from worshipping idols." He was fearful of worshipping idols, meaning he wasn't full of himself. Right? He was humble. He knew that even though he's a human being, he can still make mistakes. Right? Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him a prophet, but he was humble in his dua. So what about us? Right? What about us? You know, some of us, we think, you know what? I'm never going to commit that sin. But perhaps shaitan has misled people that were more knowledgeable than us and did more acts of worship than us. Right? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, amongst the first people that will be thrown into Jahannam, a man that will be dragged on his face in Jahannam, Before the before the idol worshippers, before the disbelievers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us it's a scholar who learned knowledge and he only did it for the people. He did it so people say, MashaAllah, brother, you have such a nice Quran recitation. You have so much knowledge, right? You're teaching us these stories. You're giving this lecture, MashaAllah, in this masjid, MashaAllah. You're such a great scholar. You're such a great brother. And he only taught the people because he wanted to show off. And he's going to be dragged on his face, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. He's going to be dragged on his face and thrown into the fire. Right? So it doesn't matter who you are. You should never be self-righteous. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said, "Oh Allah, keep me and my children away from worshipping idols." Ibrahim alayhi salam, he also says, "Rabbi ja'alni muqima as-salati wa min dhurriyyati. Rabbana wa taqabbal du'a." He says, "Oh Allah, make me an establisher of the salah." Right? Increase me in my salah. Make it so that I am constantly praying. And also make my children established upon the salah. So this was the dua that Ibrahim alayhi salam, this was the dua that he made. Now, in terms of Ibrahim's dua, after he made this dua, he says, "Oh Allah, make me an establisher of the salah, and from my progeny, from my children, make them establishers of the salah as well." At the end of that dua, he says, "Rabbana wa taqabbal dua." He says, "Oh Allah, accept this dua. Oh Allah, accept my dua." Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted this dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored his children. So we're going to stop talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam for now, and we're going to start talking about his kids, because it's as a result of the duas he made. So speaking about his children is speaking about him. So when it comes to the lineage of Ibrahim, and I want you guys to pay very close attention, I promise you it's going to get really interesting. I promise you. Ibrahim alayhi salam, it's already interesting. Right, but it's going to get very, very interesting shortly, inshallah. Ibrahim alayhi salam, how many sons did he have? Two sons? Just two? The scholars mentioned that he had more sons than two, but the most famous of them are the two prophets, the two sons that he had. And what were their names? Ismail, we spoke about Ismail, and Ishaq. Who was older, Ismail or Ishaq? Ismail was older, right? Ismail alayhi salam was older. So Ismail alayhi salam, he was older, and then after that Ishaq was born. Now, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had these two sons, right? We're not going to talk about the rest of his sons, but just these two. We don't really know much about his other sons anyway. So Ismail, when it comes to Ismail now, what do we know about Ismail alayhi salam? We know Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had to slaughter Ismail. That is what he was commanded with, and eventually he did not slaughter Ismail. But where did this take place? Where did this commandment take place? Where? In Mecca. How did Ibrahim get in Mecca? He was originally in Sham, Ash-Sham in Philistine. This is where Ibrahim alayhi salam was. How did he get all the way to Mecca? Why would he go to Mecca? How come Ismail is in Mecca? Somebody tell me. Huh? Of course he walked, or perhaps he traveled on a camel or horse, whatever they had. But he had to travel, of course. But how, Ibrahim, he's in Ash-Sham. And Ismail is in Mecca. How did that happen? Yeah, Samaniya. Good. When Ismail was born, right? When Ismail was born, Allah commanded Ibrahim to take Ismail and his mother. What was his mother's name? What was Ismail's mom's name? Hajar, right? Ibrahim's wife. So Ibrahim alayhi salam took his wife Hajar and his little son Ismail. Ismail was just a baby. He didn't remember this. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took Hajar and Ismail all the way from Ash-Sham, from this area, and took them all the way to the Arabian Peninsula in Mecca. Now there was nobody living there. It was like pretty much like barren. Now you can imagine that Ibrahim is leaving his wife and his baby son here. There's nothing here. There's no water. Period. There's nothing here. Hajar, she's left here with her baby, and Ibrahim, he leaves them, and he goes back. And they don't know exactly why they're here, right? Hajar alayhi salam, she asked Ibrahim, did Allah command you to leave us here? And Ibrahim said, yes, Allah commanded me to leave you guys here. So this was enough for Hajar, right? She said, you know what, if Allah commanded you, maybe there's a wisdom. Perhaps I don't see it now, but eventually I will see it. So Ibrahim, he departs, he leaves. And Hajar is here with baby Ismail. Now she has food, she has some dates, she has some water. Eventually, what's gonna happen? He's gonna run out. Babies, they eat a lot, right? So feeding baby Ismail, she runs out of water. And what does she do after that? there's two hills, Mount Safa and Marwa. It was a lot bigger then than how it is now. But she ran between these two mountains, right, looking for anybody that could help. Right, imagine your baby is starving, what would you do, right? You'll be running around like crazy. You don't want your baby to die. And you would prefer your baby over yourself. Like, forget me, I'm old already, you know, I want to take care of the baby. So eventually, the well of Zamzam was dug. Jibril, he dug the well of Zamzam and the water came gushing out of the ground. And this is how we have the well of Zamzam and we still have it today. Well, that's a miracle, right? You know, that's a miracle that the water is still coming. Right, the water is still coming thousands and thousands of years later. So it was at this place that the water gushed up. Now when the water gushed up, who do you think is going to come by when there's water? You know, what is the first thing that's going to come by when there's water? Birds, right? Because birds are flying around. They're going to look for where the water sources are. Birds come. After birds are circling around the water, who's going to come? Other animals. And travelers. There were some travelers from Yemen, some Arabs, and they came by, and then they asked Hajar, can we settle here? Because now there's a water source. You need a water source if you want to settle somewhere. So they settled there. They asked Hajar, can we stay here? Now Hajar was like, sure, you can stay here. So now here's a question. Was Hajar and Ismail, were they Arabs? Were they Arabs? Originally, they were not Arabs. Ismail was not Arab in terms of his lineage. These people that came and they settled, they were Arabs. Now Ismail, he grew up amongst these people. And we said that it was around the age of 7 that Ibrahim, he came back and he was commanded to slaughter Ismail. So Ismail didn't grow up all the time with Ibrahim. Ibrahim would come and he would visit occasionally, right? Just to check up on his son, right? Amongst those times is when he came to, with the commandment to slaughter his son. So, Ibrahim, you know, Ismail, he grew up amongst the Arabs. Ismail, he learned their language. He married from amongst them. And eventually, and he had charge over the well of Zamzam. Now, of course, if you have, you know, if you are in charge of the well of Zamzam, that's the biggest water source there, right? So he was the chief of his people, you know. He had a great, you know, status amongst his people. And he was a prophet. Ismail was a prophet as well. Okay? Now, when we talk about his other son, you know, we're just going to stop speaking about Ismail for now. I just want you guys to keep that thought, okay? Now, Ibrahim, he had Ismail. What was his other son? It was Ishaq. Ishaq, did Ishaq grow up with Ismail? Perhaps they met, perhaps they didn't, Allahu Alam, but Ishaq did not grow up with Ismail. Ishaq grew up in Sham, in Palestine, along with his father. So, Ishaq, alayhi salam, Ishaq was a prophet as well. Ishaq, Allah has made Ishaq a prophet. So now Ismail was a prophet, and Ishaq is also a prophet as well. Now Ishaq, he grows up, and Ishaq has a son that is also a prophet. Who is his son that's a prophet? Who is Ishaq's son that was a prophet? We've mentioned it in Salah al-Maghrib. I recited the verse. Yaqub. So I'm going to choose on a random person, Abdurrahman. How is Yaqub related to Ibrahim? Ibrahim is the son of Ishaq? Good, so Ibrahim is the father, then you have Ishaq, and Ishaq has Ya'qub. Okay, good. Ya'qub is Ibrahim's grandfather. Ibrahim is Ya'qub's grandfather, okay? Ibrahim is Ya'qub's grandfather. Good, now Ya'qub had a son. I mean, just keep up with me. Trust me, everything will come together, inshallah. Ya'qub had a son who was also a prophet. Who was he? Yusuf, right? We know the story of Yusuf. Ya'qub was actually the grandson of Ibrahim. So what does that make Yusuf to Ibrahim? His great-grandson. So Yusuf's great-grandpa was Ibrahim, right? I mean, like, talk about parents there, right? You got your father as a prophet, your grandfather as a prophet, your great-grandfather is, like, amongst the best of the prophets, right? What more could you ask for? So Yusuf, alayhi salam, how many brothers did Yusuf have? 11 brothers. So how many sons did Ya'qub have? 12 sons. Okay, good. Now, Ya'qub, he was known by another name as well. Right? So Ibrahim, he is, you know, he passed away. Yeah, you know, Ishaq, he passes away. Ya'qub, the grandson of Ibrahim, he was also known by a name. What was his name as well? Allah refers to him by this name in the Quran as well. Huh? Israel. Israel. Ya'qub was known as Israel. This is what he was known as. Just like, for example, Isa is known as Al-Masih. Al-Masih ibn Maryam, right? The Messiah, or you know, that's how it's translated. But Israel was also the name of, who is Israel the name of? Yaqub, okay? Okay, now Israel is Yaqub. Now Yaqub alayhi salam, he had 12 sons. Right, this is one of the most important points of this lecture. I want you guys to pay attention. Trust me, it'll all come together. Israel, Yaqub had 12 sons. Amongst them is Yusuf. Now these 12 sons had so many kids. So many children, like kids after kids. Like each and every single one of these 12 sons, they had like a tribe for themselves. You know, mashallah, some people that have so many kids, it's like a mini tribe, like a mini, you know, like a football team. It was just like that. Each and every single one of these sons, they had so many children. So Yaqub, he had a lot of grandkids. Now, we have to just talk about where Yaqub alayhi salam was. Where did Yaqub alayhi salam and his sons end up living? At the end of the story of Yusuf, yeah. In Egypt, right? So Yaqub, remember at the end of the story of Yusuf, Yaqub moves into Egypt. Was Yusuf originally from Egypt? How did he get in Egypt? He was brought there as a slave, right? They took him out of the well, they brought him to Egypt as a slave. Eventually, the brothers, they come to Egypt, they see Yusuf, and they go back and they bring their father, and eventually everybody, they move into Egypt with Yusuf. Because Yusuf, he had a great job, right? He was pretty much in charge of the finances of Egypt. So Yusuf brought in his dad, Yaqub, right? He regained his sight, and they lived in Egypt. Okay, so, good. So Yaqub had 12 sons, they move into Egypt, they have a bunch of kids. Now, Yaqub's children, right, they're, like I said, these 12 sons of Yaqub, they had so many kids that it was like a whole nation. They are called in the Quran, Bani Israel. This is who Bani Israel is. A lot of people, you know, a lot of times we read in the Quran, Ya Bani Israel. We heard, you know, the brother recite, you know, very beautifully, mashallah, Ya Bani Israel. Who is Bani Israel? We hear a lot of the times in the Quran, you know, Bani Israel. We hear the Imam talking, you know, on the minbar about Bani Israel during the khutbah. Who is Bani Israel? These are the people that were Bani Israel. So Bani Israel were the descendants of the 12 sons of Yaqub. Is everybody clear on this? So those 12 sons and all of their children, they're directly related to who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Is everybody with me here? So they are directly related to Ibrahim alayhi salam. طيب. So they lived in Egypt. Now, eventually, the pharaohs took over, okay? And generations after generations passed. And who comes into power? Fir'aun. Now, Fir'aun, he starts to subjugate the people of Bani Israel. He started to subjugate the Israelites. Now, who was from amongst the Israelites? Who was from amongst Bani Israel that faced Fir'aun? Musa! So Musa is from Bani Israel. In other words, Musa is from the lineage of Ibrahim. Right? So Musa alayhi salam comes, his brother is Harun. The story we all know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves Bani Israel. Allah parts the sea. Bani Israel, they come through, Fir'aun, he gets washed up, and he dies. Alright, Allah says Bani Israel, okay? Bani Israel, they pass by, and then they move into Asham, into Palestine. And then eventually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Musa dies, Allah kept on giving them prophets. Now, when it comes to the lineage of Ibrahim, when it comes to Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمْ. In Surah Ali Imran, Allah, he says, indeed Allah has chosen Adam, wa ala Ibrahim, wa Nuhan. Allah says that indeed Allah has chosen Nuh. So Nuh was the chosen one. Adam was the chosen one. Wa ala Ibrahim, and Allah has chosen the family of Ibrahim. Wa ala Imran ala al-alamin, and the family of Imran over all of creation. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the children of Ibrahim, the descendants of Ibrahim, his family, Allah has favored them over creation, period. Imagine the amount of things that Allah has created. Allah has favored these groups of people over all of humanity, over all of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says about the, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran about the things that he has favored Bani Israel with. Allah, he says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا وَإِبْرَاهِيمًا. Allah says, and we have certainly sent Nuh, and we have certainly sent Ibraheem. وَجَعَلْنَا فِي ذُرِّيَّتِهِمَ النُّبُوَّةَ وَالْكِتَابَ. Allah says, and we have placed in their lineages. Allah has placed in the lineage of Nuh. Allah has placed in the descendants of Ibrahim al-hukma wal-nubuwwah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them scripture. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them prophethood. So how did Allah favor Bani Israel? Allah gave them a lot of prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them a lot of prophets. And that is why, you know, when we talk about the prophets that were mentioned in the Quran, how many prophets were mentioned in the Quran? 25 prophets. How many of these prophets were from the descendants of Ibrahim? 16 prophets. Can you imagine this? 16 prophets of the Quran were from the descendants of Ibrahim. Look, we've just mentioned Ibrahim had two sons, Ismail and Ishaq. That's two, right? We have Yaqub, we have Yusuf, we have Musa, we have Harun, and we have most of the other prophets of the Quran: Zakariya, Yahya, Isa, Ilyas, Ilyasar, Yunus, Dawud, Sulaiman. All of these prophets were from Bani Israel. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored Bani Israel generation after generation with prophet after prophet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحُكْمَ وَالنُّبُوَّةِ. Allah, He says, we have certainly given Bani Israel the scripture. Allah has given them the Torah. Musa, the book that he got was the Torah. Right? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got the Quran. Musa got the Torah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the book. وَالْحُكْمَ. Allah gave them rulership. Allah has given them a kingdom. We know that Sulaiman alayhi salam, he was a prophet of Bani Israel. What did he have that no other prophet had? He had a kingdom that no other prophet had. Sulaiman, he said, رَبِّ هَبْلِي مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحْدٍ مِّن بَعْدِي. Sulaiman, he made a dua to Allah. This is in Surah Sad. He says, O Allah, O my Lord, grant me a kingdom that no one will have after me. Sulaiman ruled over Bani Israel. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them kingship. Allah gave them, you know, kingdoms, generation after generation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَرَزَقْنَاهُ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. And we have provided them so many good things. وَفَضَّلْنَاهُمْ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. And we have preferred Bani Israel over all of creation. So just think about this. You know, in Surah Al-Dukhan, Allah, He says, وَلَقَدْ اخْتَرْنَاهُمْ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says that we have favored, we have chosen Bani Israel. They were just they were the chosen people before us. Bani Israel, they were the chosen people before us. And Allah says that we have chosen them over all of creation. Many places in the Quran. So you see that throughout the Quran, Allah praises Bani Israel, the children of these 12 sons of Ya'qub, generation after generation. Now, when it comes to Bani Israel, eventually they were misled. Eventually they followed their desires and they went to the dark side. They became bad, right? Now, during the time of Musa, even during then, Bani Israel, they believed in Musa, but a lot of them, they had a lot of problems. You know, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went up in the night of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, when he went up to the heavens, when he went past space, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went past this earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him with how many salawat at the beginning? 50. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came down to Musa alaihi salam, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam come down to earth? Where was Musa? The Prophet came down from Allah to Musa. Where was Musa? In which heaven? In the sixth heaven, right? Now, how many levels does Jannah have? No, that's not Jannah. When we talk about the heavens, we're not talking about Jannah. This is different, right? Right, a lot of people have this misconception that Jannah has seven levels because of the confusion of the word Sama. Sama means skies. Sama means whatever is above, right? So Jannah, the Prophet ﷺ tells us hadith in Tirmidhi, إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ مِئَةَ دَرَجَةً. Hadith al-Sahih, in Tirmidhi, the Prophet ﷺ says that Jannah has 100 levels, not seven. Common misconception. Many people think Jannah has seven levels. Jannah has seven levels. The seventh heaven, people think that that's Jannah. It's not Jannah. Okay? Jannah is different. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ went down to Musa alayhi salam in the sixth heaven, the sixth space, the sixth sky, however you want to translate it. Layer of heaven, of space, whatever you want to call it. But the Sama, the sixth Sama, the Prophet ﷺ came down and told Musa that Allah is commanding me and my people with 50 salawat. What did Musa say? What did he say? He said, go back. My people what? Couldn't handle this. They gave me too much problems. Musa had a lot of problems dealing with his people. Just read the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, you'll see what I'm talking about. Allah commands, you know, Musa commands his people to, you know, to slaughter a cow. They say, you know, what is the color? How old does a cow have to be? They gave him a hard time, didn't they? Right after Allah saved Bani Israel from Fir'aun, what did they fall in right after that? Idol worship. Right after they came past the sea, imagine this. Allah is saving you. Allah is putting you, like literally splitting the sea so you can walk through. And they disbelieve right after that. They commit shirk after that. And what do they worship? Good, the golden calf. They worship this cow, right? They worship this cow. And they started worshiping this idol. Can you imagine this? After Allah has saved them, Bani Israel, they went astray. So they kept going astray. And they kept coming back. They kept making tawbah, going astray, coming back. And eventually they became corrupted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Allah tells us about Bani Israel, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَقَفَّيْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِ بِالرُّسُلِ Allah, he says, and we have given the book, the Torah, to Musa, and we have continuously sent messenger after Musa. Right? After Musa died, after Harun died, Allah continuously sent messenger after messenger. Every time a messenger would die, another prophet would come. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored Bani Israel like this. Allah didn't just leave them in the dark. Allah kept giving them prophet after prophet. Now, despite them being the chosen people, they took advantage of this. Right? They went astray. Like I said, they went to the dark side. They went astray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses Bani Israel. He says, أَفَكُلَّمَا جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ بِمَا لَا تَهْوَى أَنفُسُكُمْ فَرِيقًا كَذَّبَتُمْ وَفَرِيقًا تَقْتُلُونَ Allah, he says to Bani Israel, is it that every time a prophet comes to you and they tell you something that you don't like, you know, sometimes you advise people and you tell them things they don't like but they need to hear it, right? Allah is saying that every time a prophet comes to you, is it that every time he tells you something you don't like, you kill a group of the prophets and you deny the other group? They used to kill their prophets eventually. After Musa died, after Harun died, eventually they started to kill their prophets. Imagine this, imagine killing prophets, right? And Ibn Kathir and many scholars mentioned that Zakariya and Yahya, father and son, they were both prophets, according to many of the reports of Bani Israel. These, you know, you're not going to find any proofs for this from the Quran and Sunnah. You're going to find it from the books of the Jews and the Christians, right? From the books of the Jews and the Christians, it mentions that Zakariya and Yahya, they were both murdered by Bani Israel. And Zakariya and Yahya, they were alive during which prophet? During the time of which prophet? Of Isa alayhi salam. Who did they try to kill as well? Isa alayhi salam. They tried to kill Jesus. But did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow them to kill Isa? No. Right? We know that the sign that Isa came to them with. What were some of the signs that Isa came to his people, to Bani Israel with? Yeah. Good. He made somebody come out the grave. What else? He brought the dead to life. What else? He cured the blind. What else? Speak in the graves. What else? Good. He made, you know, out of like a form of clay, and he molded it into a bird, and he blew into it, and he became alive. This is what Isa did. What else did he do? I mean, the Christians say he walked on water. He did a bunch of stuff. What do we know about that he did, huh? Cure the blind, we said, cure the lepers, right? Those who are afflicted with leprosy. He spoke in the cradle. He was his mom didn't have a husband, right? He was born from a virgin woman, which never happened, you know, period, right? So Isa did not have a father. And when she gave birth to Isa, Maryam took Isa. And remember, Maryam is from Bani Israel. Some of the scholars mentioned that Maryam is from the descendants of Dawood alayhi salam. And this is why when Bani Israel, when they addressed Maryam, they say, Ya Ukhta Harun. They said, oh, sister of Harun. Maryam was not the sister of Harun, but she was from his descendants. Right? So Maryam, she gives birth to Isa. She brings baby Isa to her people. The people are like, wait, you don't have a husband. How did you get this baby? Right? You know, they said, you know, مَا كَانَ أَبُوكِ امْرَأَ سَوْءٍ وَمَا كَانَتْ أُمُّكِ بَغِيَّةٍ They said, your father was not an immoral man and your mother was not a prostitute. How are you going to bring this baby to us? Right? We can't accept this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told her to fast from speaking. Do not speak. Right? If anybody speaks to you, do not speak. Tell them that I have fasted for Ar-Rahman. I have fasted for Allah. So Allah mentions in Surah Maryam, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. Maryam, all she did was point to Isa, right? Isa then spoke. He spoke as a baby, right? Can you imagine, a little tiny baby, newborn baby, she's just coming to her people, and he's speaking eloquent, with eloquent speech. He says, إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ آتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ وَجَعْلَنِي النَّبِيَّ. Isa spoke as a baby in his mother's arms. He said that, that I am the slave of Allah. He has given me the book, he has given me the scripture, and he has made me a prophet, right? And then he says, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. And he has made me blessed wherever I may be. وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. And he has commanded me with salah and zakah as long as I'm alive. وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي. And he has made me dutiful to my mom, to this one who is not speaking, right, to my mother, that you're accusing of being, all of these things. He has made me dutiful to her, and he has not made me a wretched person. Right, and then he says, وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وُلِدْتُ وَيَوْمَ أَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ أُبَعَثُ حَيَّ. He says about himself, this baby, Isa, he says, peace be upon me. The day I was born, which was just now, which is today, يَوْمَ وُلِدْتُ, and the day which I will die, and the day in which I will be resurrected. And it's the people, they were like, what? Like, whoa, this baby just spoke to us. So this was something that they saw in front of them, but many of them still disbelieved. Isa alayhi salam, he had followers, but majority of Bani Israel, they rejected him, they disbelieved in him, and they wanted to kill him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Isa alayhi salam, وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. Allah, he says that those who wanted to kill Isa, they were not able to kill him. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they did not kill him, nor did they crucify him, but it was made to look like that. So us as Muslims, we do not believe that that was Jesus that died on the cross. When the Christians, they wear the cross, and then they sing and they dance in the church, and they have the cross in there, and they have this guy laying there with a thing on his head. We don't believe that that is Isa alayhi salam. We don't believe this. We do not believe that they did this to this messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken him up. Allah azza wa jalla, he says, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرُ اللَّهِ. Allah, he says, and they plan, and Allah plans too. Right? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى. When Allah said, O Isa, إِنِّي مُتَوَفِّيكَ وَرَافِعُكَ إِلَيِّ. Allah said to Isa, before Allah took him up, Allah says, I will raise you to me. I will bring you up and I will raise you to me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not allow them to kill him. Okay, so this is our belief as Muslims, clear in the Quran. So they tried to kill Isa alayhi salam. Now, when it comes to Isa alayhi salam, Isa was the last prophet of Bani Israel. Remember, Allah mentioned that we have given Musa the book and we have sent messenger after messenger to him. Allah says this in Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah kept on giving them chances, one after another, prophet after prophet. They started killing their prophets, they went astray, and they tried to kill Isa. After this, Allah did not allow them to have another messenger. Allah deprived them of having a messenger. Is everybody with me here? Okay. So Bani Israel, remember, they are an ethnic group, right? They are descendants. They are a people that are descendants of Ibrahim alayhi salam, descendants of prophets. So remember, Bani Israel, which of the sons do Bani Israel go back to Ibrahim through? Ishaq. What about Ismail? Where was Ismail while all of this is happening? He's in Mecca and he's having kids and their descendants are living. There is no prophet after Ismail. While all of this is taking place, Ismail never, from amongst his children, he never gets a prophet except one prophet. We're going to talk about him. Now, after they tried to kill Isa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lifted up Isa to him and Allah protected Isa. Now, after this, like I mentioned, Allah never gave them a prophet again. This was their last chance and they blew it. They blew it, right? They tried to kill him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give them a prophet after this. Now, 600 years pass. 600 years pass and no prophet comes to the world. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that he was sent after Isa alayhi salam. So us as Muslims, we believe that, we believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the only prophet and the last prophet that came after Isa. Is everybody with me here? So does Allah send another prophet to Bani Israel? No. They're finished. Prophethood amongst them is finished. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He says in a hadith in Sahih Muslim, he says, "Laysa bayni wa bayna Isa, or laysa bayni wa baynahu nabiyun." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "There's no prophet between me and Isa. There's no prophet between me and Isa." And Salman al-Farisi radiyallahu anhu, hadith in Bukhari, he says, "Fatratu ma bayna Isa wa Muhammadin sallallahu alaihi wasallam 600 sana." Salman al-Farisi, we know the story of Salman, the Persian, right, radiyallahu anhu, he said the period from Isa to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is how many years? 600 years. So almost a half of a millennium, over half a millennium, Allah does not send another chosen one. Allah doesn't send another prophet. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he comes. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he is from amongst the Arabs. Where did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam grow up? In Mecca. In Mecca. Now we're going to talk about Ismail. Right? We spoke about Ishaq and Bani Israel through his lineage. Now we're going to talk about who? Ismail. Now Ismail, we said Ismail, he grew up, he lived amongst the Arabs, he married from amongst their women. Remember, they moved in Mecca. After that, he had children, there were tribes, and the, you know, society moved on. Thousands of years later, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is born. Hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, "Indeed Allah has chosen Kinana, the tribe of Kinana." Ismail, amongst his descendants, was a man by the name Kinana. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that Allah has chosen Kinana from the children of Ismail. And Allah has chosen Quraysh from Kinana. And Allah has chosen Banu Hashim from Kinana, and Allah has chosen me from Banu Hashim. Hadith in Sahih Muslim, as well as At-Tirmidhi and other books. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us here that after generations passed, Allah chose this tribe Kinana. From amongst this tribe Kinana, you had the sub-tribe Quraysh, they got bigger. From amongst the tribe of Quraysh, you had Banu Hashim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is from Banu Hashim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that Allah chose me from Banu Hashim. Now, brothers and sisters, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he is related to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam through who? Through Ismail. Through Ismail. And between Ismail and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is there any prophet? No. The Arabs never get a prophet after this. Why? Because Allah has favored who? Bani Israel. Allah had favored the brethren of the Arabs. And this is why even you find in the Bible, the books of the Jews and the Christians, they refer to the children of Yaqub, the children of Ishaq, as the Israelites, and the children of the Ismail, the Arabs, as the Ishmaelites. In biblical terms, in the Bible, the Ishmaelites are the Arabs, the descendants of Ismail. So now when we talk about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was commanded to come to Mecca to build something. And that was the Kaaba. Now, was Ibrahim alayhi salam the first one to build the Kaaba? No. Who built the Kaaba first? Before Ibrahim, years before Ibrahim, who built the Kaaba? The angels. The angels? Okay, so is it the angels or is it Adam? Good. These are the two opinions amongst the scholars. Now, in terms of who built the Kaaba at the beginning, there is no verse in the Quran, and there is no authentic hadith. There is no authentic, like I said, authentic hadith. There are weak hadiths, there are statements of scholars, but we don't have a single revealed text telling us who built the Kaaba. Some scholars say it's the angels, other scholars say it's Adam, but we don't know for sure. But we know that it was built before. Ibrahim, he was just commanded to lift it up again, to erect the Kaaba again. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we're going to close after this part of the story, inshallah. Everything will come together, inshallah. I promise you. Ibrahim alayhi salam, remember, he's not from Mecca. Okay? Allah, he says in Surah Al-Hajj, Allah, he says, وَإِذْ بَوَّأْنَا لِإِبْرَاهِيمَ مَكَانَ الْبَيْتِ. And when we showed Ibrahim the place of the house, so the Kaaba was present, but it wasn't erected, right? It wasn't built. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Ibrahim and Ismail. This is when Ismail gets a lot older. Right? So remember, what happened with the slaughter, he was commanded to slaughter. That was when Ismail was a kid. Years later, Ibrahim, he comes back and he visits. Right? And he comes and he says to Ismail that, you know what, Allah is commanding us to build the Kaaba, to construct this structure. Now Ibrahim alayhi salam, he comes, and him and Ismail, they're building together, father and son, right? They're, this is a bonding experience, you can imagine, right? Ibrahim and Ismail, they're building this Kaaba, you know, the Kaaba, they have their tools, they have all of their stuff. Now, while they're building the Kaaba, they make a dua. They make a dua. And this is in Surah Al-Baqarah, okay? Allah, he mentions, وَإِذْ يَرَفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ. And remember, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember when Ibrahim and Ismail, while they were building the Kaaba, while they were raising the foundations of the Kaaba, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Ibrahim and Ismail, they made a dua together. Is Ishaq here? He's not here. He's all the way in Hashem. He's all the way in Palestine, wherever he is. Right? Ismail and Ibrahim, they're in Mecca, in Ismail's hometown. They say, oh Allah, accept from us. While they're building, they say, oh Allah, accept from us. You are the one who hears and you are the one who knows. Then they continue. It's a very long dua. We're going to mention the whole thing. They say, رَبَّنَا وَجَعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكْ. They say, oh Allah, make us both Muslims to you. Now what does Muslim mean? What does Islam mean? What does Islam mean? Islam. Good, right? A lot of people, they say Islam means peace. Islam means peace. Okay, you get peace from Islam, but Islam means al-istislam. Islam means submission. So a Muslim is one who submits. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. Allah says, we have not sent a messenger except that he spoke the language of his people so that he can clarify the message to them. So we know that the Arabs spoke Arabic, Ismail spoke Arabic, but the other prophets before him did not speak Arabic like that. Okay, they did not speak Arabic like that, okay? They spoke other languages. So in those nations, amongst those prophets, perhaps they use a different word than Islam, because Islam is an Arabic word. So the word Islam literally means somebody, the word Muslim literally means somebody who has Islam, somebody who has submission, somebody who submits. So if you call it the one who submits or you call it Muslim, it's the same thing, right? So don't think Muslim is some fancy Arabic word that has no meaning. Okay? It has a meaning. It means one who submits to God. Anybody who accepts the messengers of Allah, all of them, anybody who believes in all of the books of Allah, anybody who submits to Allah is a Muslim. Okay? And this is why you find even Arab, you know, Arab Christians, they refer to Allah as Allah. Arab Christians, they say MashaAllah, they say Alhamdulillah, they say SubhanAllah, just like we do. Okay? So Arab Christians, they refer to God as Allah. Okay? Because in Arabic, we refer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Allah. Whether you call him God, whether you call him the Almighty, he's Allah to us, okay? Now, as they're making this dua, they say, oh Allah, make us Muslims to you. Ismail and Ibrahim, they're saying, oh Allah, make us submitters to you. وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكْ. And make from our progeny a submitting nation to you. Now think about this. Ismail is making this dua. Could this submitting nation that will come after, could they be from the lineage of Ishaq? Definitely not, because Ishaq is not even here. Ishaq was not an Arab. Ismail is the father of the Arabs. So Ismail and Ibrahim, they're both making this dua in Mecca. Oh Allah, make us both Muslims, and from our children that will come after us in this land, make from amongst them a submitting nation as well. Is everybody with me here? وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكِنَا وَتُبَ عَلَيْنَا. And show us how to worship you, O Allah. Show us our rights. Show us how to make hajj. Show us the rights of worshiping you. وَتُبَ عَلَيْنَا. And have, accept our repentance. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَابُ الرَّحِيمُ. You accept repentance and you're merciful. Then they continue the dua. This is both Ibrahim and Ismail. They say, رَبَّنَا وَبَعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. They say, O Allah, send amongst our children. Send amongst our descendants who will come after us, our progeny, our lineage. Send amongst them Rasulan, a messenger. Minhum, from them. So who would this messenger come from? Will he come from the Israelites or the Arabs? The Arabs. يَتْلُوَ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. He will recite upon them your book. Right? And he will teach them the book. And he will purify them. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. You are the one that is mighty, and you are the one that is wise. So this is the dua that Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail made. The only prophet that came from the Arabs. Forget prophet, the only one who claimed prophethood and had success like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nobody else. He's the only prophet that came after Ismail. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah Azza wa Jal tells us that who was the last prophet of Bani Israel from amongst them? Isa, before Isa alayhi salam, before he left, before he, you know, escaped from them, Isa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that he foretells the coming of a prophet after him. Right? Allah mentions in Surah As-Saff that, you know, Isa alayhi salam, he says, وَمُصَدِّقًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِن بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدٍ. Isa tells his people, he says that I am giving you the news, I'm confirming that there's going to be a prophet coming after me, and his name is Ahmed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was given the name Ahmed upon birth, but his grandfather gave him the name Muhammad. So he had two names, he had many names. Amongst his names was Muhammad and Ahmed. So Isa told his people that after I'm gone, a prophet will come after me, his name is Ahmed. Is Ahmed. So Musa, Isa alayhi salam, before he left, he told his people that there's going to be a prophet after me. So Bani Israel now, the believers amongst them, in their books, they had these teachings from Isa that there's going to be a prophet coming after Isa, and his name is going to be Ahmed. And there are certain other signs that he gave them. Even if you read the Bible, right? Even if you read the Bible, it mentions signs of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, not by name, because it's been translated. The name has been mentioned there. Even if you look at the Bible, it says Muhammad in the Hebrew Bible. If you hear the Jews reciting a certain, I don't remember the exact part of the Bible, I think it's in Song of Solomon's. Songs of Solomon in the Bible, in the Old Testament, Songs of Solomon, look it up. Right? Look at a Jew, you know, listen to a Jew reciting it. He says Muhammad. The only thing is that they translate the name. They translate the name. Muhammad means the praised one. Right? So when you translate a name, you don't know who it is. If I say the praised one came, you'd be like, who is that? Right? If I say, you know, Salih, what's a Salih name? What does the name Salih mean? The righteous one. If I say, you know, I just met the righteous one, you're like, who are you talking about? You mean you met Salih? So when you translate a name, it changes a lot of things. You don't even know who you're talking about anymore. In other parts of the Old Testament, it's mentioned that he will, you know, the angel will come to him. You can look this up. Go home. Do your homework. Look it up. It says the angel will come to him. It will, you know, the angel will say to him to read. He will say, I don't know how to read. He will speak in the name of Allah. He will speak in the name of the Lord. In the Quran, every single surah starts with, in the name of Allah, except Surah At-Tawbah. Right? It's even mentioned in the Bible, right? It's mentioned that this prophet will come in a place called Mount Paran. Right? And that is the place of Mecca, and he's gonna come in with 10,000 people. During when the Prophet when he conquered Mecca, how many of the Sahaba did he bring with him? 10,000. So even in the Christians' books, because remember, they are claiming to follow, you know, Bani Israel. They have these signs of this Prophet coming. So during the 600-year period between Isa and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you had many people who were trying to look for this Prophet. And this is why many of the Jews, they moved to Arabia. Right? One may ask, if they're reading the seerah, why are there Jews in Medina in the first place? It's because they were looking for this prophet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us why they came to Arabia. The Jews, when they would come to Arabia, they would say to the Arabs, they would say to them, you know what, when the prophet comes to us, Bani Israel, to the Jews, when the prophet comes to us, we're going to conquer you. Allah has mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Bani Israel, in other words, the Jews that were claiming to be from Bani Israel, they would say to the Arabs that when the Prophet comes to us, we're going to conquer you. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does Allah send the Prophet amongst the Jewish people? Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the Prophet amongst the followers of Bani Israel? No. Who does Allah send the Prophet to? Muhammad, to the Arabs. To the Arabs. So can you imagine this? If you were a Jew during that time, you're telling the Arabs, you know what? Eventually, our prophet is going to come to us, and we're going to conquer you. And then later on, the Arabs get the prophet. The Arabs get the prophet. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. Those who have been given the book, those who know the signs of this prophet, they know him like they know their own soul. They know him like they know their own sons. وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِّنْهُمْ لَيَكْتُمُونَ الْحَقَّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. And a group from amongst them, they hide the truth while they know. So brothers and sisters, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just closing this, this is a few closing remarks inshallah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أَنَا دَعْوَةُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. He says, أَنَا دَعْوَةُ أَبِي إِبْرَاهِيمُ وَبُشْرَى أَخِي عِيسَى. This is the highlight of the whole talk tonight. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, I am the dua of my father Ibrahim. I am that dua. I am the answer to that dua. Right? Wa ana bushra akhi Isa. And I am the glad tidings of my brother Isa. Why did he call Isa his brother? And why did he call Ibrahim his father? It's because Ibrahim is his great, 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 Allahu alam, how many times you're going to say great grandfather. But Isa alayhi salam is from Bani Israel. Right? It's from Bani Israel. Going to Ishaq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he's not a descendant from Ishaq. Isa is like his cousin, is like his brother. So he said, I am the glad tidings. Isa told you a prophet is going to come? That's me. Ibrahim made a dua that there's going to be, you know, that there's going to come a prophet? That is me. So just think about this for a second. Now, the title of tonight's talk was The Legacy of Ibrahim. Right? The legacy of Ibrahim. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the legacy of Ibrahim. Imagine one dua Ibrahim and Ismail make. One dua and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes. Just imagine that. One dua he makes and Muhammad, the greatest of messengers, is an answer to that dua. So this shows you should never look down on dua. Never look down on dua. Right? Because it's through Ibrahim's dua that we have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's through Ibrahim's dua that we have Islam. Remember, he made a dua, oh Allah, send them amongst a prophet from amongst them who will recite upon them your book. Which book did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give Muhammad? The Quran. The Quran. This was the answer of the dua of Ibrahim. So brothers and sisters, Ibrahim, he plays an integral role in our deen. Right? In every single salah. You know, for example, the shahada. Allah commands us to follow the way of Ibrahim, to worship Allah alone, and to not, you know, associate any partners with him. For anybody to enter into Islam, what do they have to say? La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Right? That they have to reject all false gods. This was the way of Ibrahim. Allah, he says, Millata abikum Ibrahim. Allah, he says, follow the way of your father Ibrahim. Islam is the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So that covers the shahada. What about the other four pillars? Ibrahim is connected to all of them. The salah, every single salah we say Ibrahim's name. We say Ibrahim's name. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Oh Allah, send praises upon Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad and upon the family and followers of Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim, just as you have praised and exalted and sent mercy upon Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim and upon the family of Ibrahim. Innaka hamidun majid, you are deserving of all praises and you are the exalted one. In every single salah, and then we say Allahumma barik, and we repeat a very similar dua. Every single salah, you mention Ibrahim's name. So that's the shahada, that's the salah. What about zakah? How is Ibrahim connected with zakah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَذْكُرُ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِسْمَعِيلِ. And remember in the book Ismail, إِنَّهُ كَانَ صَدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا. He was truthful and he was a prophet. Allah mentions about Ismail, وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. Allah mentions Ismail amongst the Arabs. Ismail used to command his people. He used to command his family with two things, with salah and with zakah. Ismail was the son of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Perhaps this is something that he learned from Ibrahim alayhi salam. So that's the shahada, that's salah, that's zakah. What about Ramadan? What about fasting? How is Ibrahim alayhi salam connected to this deen? How does his legacy live on in terms of fasting? When did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal his book? Which month? Ramadan. Allah, he says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. The month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran has been revealed in. This is the significance of Ramadan. Ramadan is the month of Quran. Now the Quran was the same book that Ibrahim asked Allah to send. Allah accepted this dua of Ibrahim. Allah made the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a prophet in Ramadan, and he revealed to him the Quran in Ramadan. So we fast the whole month. And I'm not saying this is a reason, but Ibrahim alayhi salam, this was the answer of his dua during this time, during that month of Ramadan. So just think about this. Every time you fast in Ramadan, this is the month of the Quran, and the Quran came as a result of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. What about Hajj? We don't even need to talk about this. He built the Kaaba that we make tawaf around. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he plays an integral role in our deen. In almost every aspect of our deen. Because whether you grow your beard, whether you pray your sunnah salah, you're following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he came as a result of that dua. Just imagine how great Ibrahim alayhi salam is in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Allah took Ibrahim as a close friend, as a khalil. So brothers and sisters, we have to understand that knowing this story, right? Knowing this story, it helps us understand who the Jews and the Christians are. Who are the Jews and the Christians? The Jews, you know, us as Muslims, we accept all of Allah's prophets. We accept all of the prophets all the way to Isa, we accept Musa, all of the prophets to, all the way to Adam, to Isa, including Muhammad. The Christians follow all of the prophets from Adam all the way to Isa, but they reject Muhammad. And the Jews, modern day Jews, they follow all of the prophets all the way up until Isa alayhi salam. And perhaps they reject Zakariya and Yahya, Allahu A'lam. But this is, when you're speaking to a Jew, you're speaking to somebody who is claiming to follow the teachings of Musa. Right? When you're talking to a Jew, you're talking about somebody who is claiming to follow all of the prophets except Isa. This is why you find, Jews, they don't accept Isa. The same reason why those who are alive during the time of Isa did not accept him, even though they saw the signs. So Jews do not accept Jesus as a prophet, period. They just look at him as a false Messiah, as a false prophet. They don't accept him. So really, those who rejected Isa during his time, they lived on, and their teachings continued until you have Jews today. Those who are Christians were those who refused to accept Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they continue following the teachings of Isa alayhi salam. Now us as Muslims, we say at the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله. We say at the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, the true believers, we say we do not make any distinction between any of Allah's messengers. Right? So we believe in all of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messengers. If you disbelieve in one messenger, you disbelieve in all of them. You disbelieve in all of them. If you are kafir in Isa, you cannot be a Muslim. That's one of the pillars of Iman, is the prophets. If you disbelieve in Isa, in Adam, any one of the prophets, you cannot be a Muslim, period. You're finished. Your Iman is done. Because if you disbelieve in one of them, they all came with the same message. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that him and all of the prophets, their religion was one. Their religion was one. So brothers and sisters, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he make us true followers of Ibrahim alayhi salam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he make us true followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, is there any questions? We're going to take some questions now, inshallah. Okay, are all the questions texted? Okay. So if you have any questions, hopefully inshallah ta'ala everything was clear. Okay, before that, we have a question. Assalamu alaikum. Did Jibreel alayhi salam dig up the well of Zamzam, or did he stop the heel of his foot causing Zamzam to gush? And is the footprint of Jibreel preserved by the place of Zamzam to this day? Allahu alam. But we know that he was the one who initiated the whole process of the water coming out. Allahu alam. I don't know whether, it was his foot or his wing or however he did. Allahu alam. Perhaps it was one of those things, but I don't know. It doesn't come to my mind right now. And is his footprint? Allahu alam. Not that I know of. Does anybody know about Jibreel's footprint, near Zamzam, the well of Zamzam? Jibreel's footprint. Allahu alam. I don't know. Wa alaykum salam. Oh, very good question. Very good question. Jazakallah khair for asking that question. Okay, good. So the question was, yes, jazakallah khair. What is the difference between what? The heaven and Jannah. The whole problem comes from English. English is causing this whole problem. Brother Said, are there any questions that you sent me from the phone? Okay, as you get them, you'll send it to me, okay. طيب, the whole problem comes from English. Now, Jannah can be translated as the garden or heaven. Because Christians, they refer to heaven as like this place with clouds and it's just a gate and just, like some wings and babies flying around with the harp. That's what they think of as heaven, right? So us as Muslims, right, we use the word heaven to refer to Jannah. But in Arabic, there's another word that can also be referred to as heaven, and that is Sama. Sama. Sama means sky, okay? The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that there are sab'a samawat. Allah mentions in many places in the Quran that there are seven samawat, seven layers of sama. Okay? Seven layers of sama. But when it comes to Jannah, it's different because Jannah is not sama. Now both Jannah in English and sama are translated as heaven. This is why when we talk about sama with the English word heaven, you may be thinking that we're talking about Jannah. Is everybody with me? Does it make sense? So I'm going to repeat that one more time. The English word heaven is commonly used to translate the Arabic words Jannah and Sama. Jannah meaning the garden that we're going to go into after we die, inshallah ta'ala, all of us, we enter it. And Sama referring to everything that is above us, right? Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the stars are in the Sama, that the moon is in the Sama, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, I mean, this is all over the, you know, the Quran. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, خَلَقَ سَبَعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا. Allah says that He has created seven samawat, seven heavens, but not Jannah. Not Jannat. He didn't say that. Jannas. Allah says samawat. He has created seven of them in layers. So inshallah ta'ala, that's clear. That when we talk about Jannah, it's different than when we're talking about as-sama, but the confusion is that both of them are translated in English as heaven. So when the khatib is saying, oh, he was in this heaven, we're thinking Jannah. But it's not. Because the Prophet said the Jannah has 100 levels. It's different. It's different. Now somebody may say, then what is the sama then? What is the sama? The Prophet ﷺ tells us, in one hadith, it's also narrated from Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu and Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. It's narrated that the Prophet ﷺ said that there are seven samawat above this earth. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِبِي مَصَابِيحِ. Allah says, we have beautified the sama of the dunya. This first sama, He has beautified it with stars. He has beautified it with stars. Now we know that in our solar system, in our galaxy, in our universe, there are billions of galaxies, and in each galaxy, there are billions of stars. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that in the lowest sama, the sama of ad-dunya, He has adorned it with stars, with lamps. وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. And we have made them as like missiles, as things to attack and to throw at the shayateen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that كِثَفُ كُلِّ سَمَاءٍ مَسِيرَةُ 500 سَنَةٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that the fastest thing you can travel on, the height of each sama is a distance of travel of 500 years. وَبَيْنَ كُلِّ سَمَاءٍ مَسِيرَةُ 500 سَنَةٍ. And between each sama there's a distance of travel of 500 years. And it keeps going up to each sama like this. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that the kursi is above the sama, the seventh sama. And above the seventh sama, above the kursi that is above that, is the bahr, is water. We don't know exactly what the reality of this is. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, وَالْعَرْشُ فَوْقَ الْبَحْرُ. And the arsh of Allah is above this bahr, this water. وَاللَّهُ فَوْقَ الْعَرْشُ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above His throne. لَيْسَ يَخْفَى عَلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ مِّنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ. Nothing from your, yet nothing from your actions is hidden from Him. So scientists today have found a certain limits of the universe that they can't observe past. And Allahu a'lam how big that is, but you can imagine we're like a tiny speck. This universe is huge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَسِعَ كُرُسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah says, and His kursi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's kursi, it encompasses all of the samawat. We can't say heavens because we're going to think it's Jannah. The samawat, let's just stick with that. It encompasses the samawat as well as the earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's kursi is huge, bigger than these samawat. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in another narration that the arsh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's throne compared to the kursi, is كَحَلْقَةٍ مِّنْ حَدِيدٍ أُلْقِيَتْ بَيْنَ ظَهْرَيْ فَلَاتٍ مِّنَ الْأَرْضِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that the kursi compared to Allah's arsh, to Allah's throne, is like a ring that is thrown into the desert. Imagine the desert and imagine how small that ring is. That is how big the arsh is in comparison to the kursi. So that is when we're talking about the samawat. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went up, he went past this earth. Okay, he went up. And however you want to translate sama as space, you want to translate it as heaven, whatever you want, but it's sama. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went up and he traveled up there into the sama. Okay? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed by each level. Right? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw prophets at different levels. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Musa at the sixth level of the sama. Allahu alam, what the reality of this is, how is he there? He passed away, how does this work? We don't know. This is from the ilmul ghaib. And the general rule is that the ilmul ghaib is that you can't use your intellect in it. Because it comes through revelation, right? I don't have to say, yes, Musa is up there and he's on some planet or something. I cannot say that. Nobody can say that. We don't know. But this is what we're talking about when we talk about the samawat, the heavens, the skies, the spaces, however you want to translate it, okay? So hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, that was clear. Any other questions? We don't know. We don't know. But the scholars have mentioned that that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He has favored Bani Israel, the scholars mentioned that that was for that time, not anymore. Not anymore. So it's not as if, you know, you see somebody who is claiming, I mean, Jews today, they claim their lineage back to Bani Israel. Jews today, okay? So the thing is it doesn't mean that, yes, you know, a Jewish person, he claims that his lineage is from Bani Israel, and he says, you know, mashallah, I am the best of people, or whatever it is. It doesn't apply to this time. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells authentic hadith. He says, لا يسمع بي أحد يهودي أو نصراني ثم لا يؤمن بي إلا كان من أصحاب النار. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, nobody hears about me, whether he be Jewish or Christian, then he does not believe in me except that he will be in the fire. Right? Except that he will be in the fire. So any Jew and any Christian, according to the Prophet ﷺ, hadith is in Sahih Muslim, who does not believe in Muhammad ﷺ, they can believe in whatever prophets they want. But if they reject one prophet, Muhammad ﷺ, then they will be from the people of the fire. Not my statements. This is from our Messenger ﷺ. So the thing is that, you know, Ibrahim, he made a dua that Allah sent a prophet amongst the Arabs. But remember, the Prophet ﷺ didn't just come to the Arabs. He came to the whole world. That's why Allah, he says, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ. In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah commands the Prophet ﷺ to say, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O mankind, إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. I am a prophet, I am a messenger to all of you. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ is a prophet to Bani Israel, but not from them. The Prophet ﷺ is a prophet to the Arabs, but not from them. The Prophet ﷺ is a prophet to everybody on the planet, black, white, and everything in between, wherever you come from. He's a prophet to people in Guyana, he's a prophet to people in Bangladesh, it doesn't matter where you're from. So that is why everybody after him, they must follow him, because there's no other messengers. Right? And the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that this is one of the specific qualities that only he has been given. Every other prophet before them, they were sent to specific people. They were sent to specific people. So Musa was sent to a specific people. He was not sent to the whole world. Isa was sent to Bani Israel. He wasn't sent to people living in America. Isa was not sent to people living in other countries. He was sent to Bani Israel. Right? So that's very important to understand. Any other questions? Okay, now, good. His mother. Huh? Oh yes. You know, it was mentioned that Ismail alayhi salam, he was not an Arab. Can you shed some light on that and speak a bit about his mother? Hajar alayhi salam. I remember. You know, if my memory serves me correctly, Hajar alayhi salam was given to Ibrahim. Was given to his wife Sarah. Hajar was given to Ibrahim's wife Sarah as a servant, as a slave. Sarah gives Hajar to Ibrahim alayhi salam as a wife. Ibrahim, he marries Hajar, and they have Ismail. Some of the scholars of Sirah, they mentioned that Hajar, she was a slave from Egypt. So perhaps, in terms of the Arabian Peninsula coming from there, Allahu alam, we can't really say that Ismail was an Arab in that regard. But Ismail, he married amongst them, he spoke their language, his culture was Arab, but not through his lineage from Ibrahim alayhi salam. So we can't say that Ismail was Arab as if, you know, he was, you know, like those who came after them. But everybody, you know, in terms of the Arabs, they are descended from Ismail alayhi salam, generally speaking, right? Generally speaking. Yes, right? Anybody else? Have any other questions? Yes. What was the question again? You're saying, how come Zamzam water, you know? Okay, Zamzam water, the Prophet ﷺ, he tells us that the Prophet ﷺ, he says, if my memory serves me correctly, he says an authentic hadith. He says that Zamzam is ta'amu tu'min wa shifa'u suqmin. The Prophet ﷺ says that Zamzam is a food. It nourishes, and the Prophet ﷺ says that it is a cure for ailments. It's a cure for sicknesses as well. So Zamzam water has special qualities. It's not like other water, right? It's narrated that even some of the pious predecessors that they would survive for like a whole month just by drinking Zamzam water. So Zamzam water has special qualities. It's not like other water, but I mean, hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, that answers the question. But Allahu A'lam of any, other specific virtues of Zamzam water. But it's something that's continuously, I mean, wallahi, just think about that, right? That, Zamzam water is continuously gushing for thousands of years, right? It's really amazing. Any other questions? Any question, it's fine. Don't be shy.
What is the tribe that Ishmael and Hagar when they did this to discover Zamzam water?
I believe the name of the tribe was Jurhum. I believe this, if my memory serves me correctly, it was Jurhum. They came from the original Arabs of Mecca, they were from Yemen. They came from Yemen. They were traveling, they were on a journey, and then they passed by, they saw Hajar, and they came and they settled there. Right? Anybody else? Anything from the sisters? About the same? Anything else? Yes.
How long is a millennium?
A millennium is 1,000 years. Yeah. Question? Okay, so inshallah ta'ala, we're going to stop here. Jazakumullah khair for listening and being patient. But hopefully inshallah everything came together. I know I was talking about a bunch of stuff. You guys are like, what's the point of this? But inshallah ta'ala, it came together at the end. Hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر